Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bloody Verrieres, the first SS-Panzerkorps defense of the Verrieres-Bourguebus ridges. Volume 1, Operations Goodwood and Atlantic, July 18th to 22nd, 1944, by Arthur W. Gullachsen. Narrated by Bruce Mann. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to maps present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. In Bloody Verrieres, the first volume of a two-volume study of the critical period the 18th of July to the 3rd of August 1944, Arthur Gullachsen presents a definitive account of the 1st SS Panzerkorps' ferocious defence of the high ground south and southeast of Caen, between the 18th and the 22nd of July 1944. He offers the most detailed, accurate, and balanced analysis of the German defence yet written. Effectively utilising the limited surviving German wartime archival records, supplemented with Anglo-Canadian archival documents, memoirs, and secondary studies, Gullachsen recreates the organisation, leadership, composition and operations of the 1st SS Panzerkorps to a hitherto unprecedented degree. In doing so, he demolishes four historical orthodoxies. In a ferocious defence, the 1st SS Panzerkorps savaged the armoured spearheads of the 2nd British Army and effectively annihilated the 29th British Armoured Brigade. Yet his most compelling conclusion is that while the Germans achieved a spectacular defensive success, their victory was pyrrhic. It was achieved only at the cost of denuding other sectors of the front of resupply and reinforcement, and thereby directly contributed to the collapse of the German defence of Normandy in late July 1944. Moreover, he argues that, despite this remarkable defensive victory, the Germans were nonetheless doomed to inevitable defeat by the inept, myopic, strategic micromanagement of their Führer Adolf Hitler, as the Germans found themselves locked in an attritional battle that they could not possibly win. Nonetheless, superior tactics, better weaponry, greater combat experience, and the aggressive spirit of the elite Waffen-SS inflicted multiple battlefield defeats on Anglo-Canadian forces, exploiting the latter's over-reliance on artillery dominance and their inferior quality armour. Secondly, Gullachsen demonstrates that the 1st SS Panzerkorps commander, SS General Josef Sepp Dietrich, was not, as often portrayed, a military incompetent, who owed his command to being one of the closest Nazi old fighters of Adolf Hitler. Instead, Gullachsen illustrates that Dietrich was actually the most experienced German commander in Normandy, and that he used his expertise and that of his staff to orchestrate a masterful defensive counterstrike. Dietrich redeployed the 1st SS Panzer Division Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler from reserve, moved it forward under sustained repeated Allied air attack, and then launched, without infantry or artillery support, two devastatingly effective armoured counterattacks, utilising superior tactics, technology, experience and aggression that smashed multiple Allied armoured spearheads. Thirdly, Gullachsen concludes that the 1st SS Panzer Division played the decisive role in stalling Montgomery's Operation Goodwood offensive, a reality that has not been sufficiently recognised hitherto. Finally, he argues that SS Lieutenant Colonel Joachim Piper, the commander of the 1st SS Panzer Regiment, played a pivotal role in Dietrich's defensive success. A controversial figure, most infamously known for his involvement in the Malmedy massacre during the Battle of the Bulge, Gullachsen argues that Piper achieved his most impressive military accomplishment of his career during these crucial 5 days. The work begins with a detailed background that explains the German way of war in Normandy during summer 1944. Gullachsen demonstrates that the 2nd British Army faced an opponent of variable quality and capabilities that nonetheless was a military effective force still capable of inflicting grievous losses. He documents the many strengths and weaknesses of the defending German forces, concluding that they had few options but to be as extremely militarily efficient and effective as possible in matters they could control, and tried to attrit the Allies to the negotiating table. Subsequent chapters provide detailed overviews of the 1st SS Panzerkorps' organization, structure, deployment, command personalities, and operational procedures on the eve of Operation Goodwood. Contrary to German doctrine, overwhelming Allied superiority compelled Dietrich to forward deploy much of his armor to backstop his frontline infantry that were incapable of resisting superior Allied firepower without armored support. The bulk of the book then presents the most detailed examination of the Corps' defense against Operations Goodwood and Atlantic between the 18th and the 22nd of July ever written. The result is a definitive tactical operational study of the 1st SS Panzerkorps' determined defense of the high ground south of Caen during those crucial late July days. Bloody Verrieres is therefore a must-read for anyone interested in the Normandy campaign, the German army, the Waffen-SS, the German way of war, and World War II. Russell A. Hart, PhD, Professor of History, Hawaii Pacific University. Introduction. The Fighting East of the Orne, the 18th of July to the 3rd of August 1944. It can be argued that Allied armies in Normandy very rarely met the Germans on equal terms on the battlefield. Allied air and artillery superiority, and the rate at which new combat units and resources were delivered into the bridgehead, made this scenario virtually impossible. Operating within a disintegrating logistical and transport network, and facing ongoing resistance from the Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, OKW, High Command of the German Armed Forces, Supreme Command on utilization of available reserves, German generals faced a challenging command environment in July 1944. Multiple factors made moving resources to and around the front increasingly difficult, and the ability to quickly match the Allies in sheer combat power in time to save a crisis situation was limited. Commanders in France were forced to make critical decisions on where and how to concentrate their most powerful forces, and to attempt the best they could with these ever-shrinking resources to defeat Allied attacks. Due to the rapidly increasing combat power of the Allies, the obvious danger to the German front in Normandy by midsummer was deploying its major resources in the wrong spot. If this occurred, forces could not be rapidly shifted from one section of the front to another. An even greater danger was the very real possibility that multiple major Allied efforts could be made simultaneously. By mid-July, there were not enough German forces or resources to successfully meet two major onslaughts, and the ability to move them quickly to a threatened area of the front was limited. This second scenario was exactly what occurred in late July 1944, and thus decided the military campaign in Normandy. By late July 1944, the cumulative effects of gradual attrition during June and early July led to a complete collapse of the Western Normandy defences, allowing the US 7th Corps to achieve a decisive breakthrough on the 27th of July. This breakthrough, part of the larger US Operation Cobra, marked the beginning of the end for German forces in France. The conditions on the German 7th Army front in the west facing the US Army stood in stark contrast to those present south of Caen in July 1944. There, a very large number of elite Panzerdivisionen, armored divisions, had been concentrated to conduct a competent defense in depth against what was seen by the Germans to be the preeminent threat, an Anglo-Canadian armoured breakthrough south of Caen. Believing the 1st US Army could be contained in the wooded, hedgerow-encased squares of Bocage country to the west, and seeing this terrain as unsuitable for large-scale armoured operations, the German focus swung to the eastern part of the bridgehead in late June. Following their partial containment of the 8th British Corps, U.S. Army Corps utilize Roman numerals, while Commonwealth Corps use Arabic numbers, armored offensive. The 18th to the 20th of July's Operation Goodwood, German analysis more than ever came to the conclusion that the focus of their defensive effort must lay south of the city of Caen. Subsequent German efforts saw the deployment of scarce powerful resources to defend two key topographical features over a roughly 13-kilometer stretch of front. From these two vantage points, perfect observation to the north, east, and west could be utilized to gain excellent tactical advantages with regard to direct and indirect fire. To hold the front south of Caen and dominate the excellent tank country in the area, German commanders at all levels saw these two high features as of the highest strategic importance. Their loss would make the German Hauptkampflinie, HKL, main defensive line, untenable and unhinge their eastern defences. The first of these terrain figures was Hill or Point 112 and its nearby Hill 113, these points being the height in metres above sea level, near the village of Esque, south of the Odon River. The British attacks in June and July to capture and hold this piece of vital ground and advance south and east have been the subject of extensive study by military historians. In two epic battles between the 8th British Corps and defending elements of the 1st and 2nd SS Panzerkorps, Waffen-SS armoured corps containing two or more divisions, during Operations Epsom and Jupiter, the attackers twice captured Hill 112, only to see it partially regained by German counterattacks. The second major area of vital terrain, and the battles to control it and its villages, as illustrated in Map 1, is the subject of this two-volume set. This second elevated feature south of Caen is much larger, and is actually two distinct pieces of ground. The first is the smaller kidney-bean-shaped Verrieres Ridge, with the nearby villages of Mer-sur-Orne, Verrieres, and Fontenay-le-Marmion. The second, larger feature is Bourgebus Ridge, which encompasses the villages of Rocancourt, Tilly-la-Compagne, and Garcelles-Secqueville. The smaller Verrieres feature is dominated by the height of Hill 88, and is independent in that it does not connect with the Bourgebus feature. To aid the listener and fly in the face of the Canadian accounts of the Verrieres Ridge fighting, all points, heights in metres above sea level, as they were marked on the original British Army maps, will be referred to as hills. As an example, Point 67 is now Hill 67 to provide continuity with Hill 112 and Hill 113 across the Orne, and similar references to hills in German accounts. The ground dips near the village of Verrieres, then rises again, marking the beginning of Bourgebus Ridge. While Bourgebus Ridge ends near the village of La Hogue in the east, its height extends far to the south and is overseen by the dominating Hill 112 near the village of Cramenil, also referred to as the Cramenil Spur. Bisecting the western portion of Bourgebus Ridge in 1944 was the paved two-lane Route Nationale 158, RN 158, which ran north-south at a slight northwest angle, connecting the southern industrial sections of Caen with the city of Falaise to the south. As a result of the undulating nature of these twin features, only a small portion of their total area is observable from any one vantage point on them today. However, from virtually any point on these features in 1944, large portions of ground to Caen's immediate south were visible, making them very useful for the observation of movement and adjustment of artillery fire. The control of both ridges was absolutely critical for the German defensive effort against what occurred in the period the 18th of July to the 3rd of August 1944. Multiple determined Anglo-Canadian efforts to gain the Verrieres-Bourguebus ridges and exploit south, utilising firepower to do so, were launched in late July. Because of the importance of these twin high features, Anglo-Canadian offensive operations in late July aimed at the Verrieres-Bourguebus positions were met with a ferocious defence, well supported by scarce powerful resources. What is not acknowledged in many works of German military history is that the Heer, German army, and Waffen-SS, military wing of the Nazi Party, were at the height of their combat powers in the summer of 1944. Never before or again were more German armoured and infantry divisions and independent corps-level units at higher strength or better equipped, especially in Normandy. That they suffered cataclysmic defeats in this period was due primarily to the inept strategic leadership of the OKW Supreme Headquarters, dominated by the person of German Chancellor and Führer, leader Adolf Hitler. Also interfering in military matters right down to the tactical level, Hitler's micromanagement of in-theater commanders further impaired a German Westheer, Army of the West, that simply did not have the resources to match the Allies. Suffering terrible losses due to Allied air superiority and artillery supremacy, German forces were trapped in an attritional battle they did not have the resource base to win. This is not to state that the Germans were completely helpless in July 1944. Powerful German counterattacks to the south of Caen inflicted tremendous casualties, regained lost ground, and at times defeated 8th British and 2nd Canadian Corps operations in detail. These defeats, and the result of meeting an enemy with near-equal resources in certain sectors, exposed a flawed Anglo-Canadian offensive doctrine that was overly dependent on the battlefield supremacy of the Royal Artillery, RA, and Royal Canadian Artillery, RCA. Furthermore, weaknesses in Allied armour technology inhibited the Royal Armoured Corps, RAC, and Canadian Armoured Corps, CAC, from fighting and winning a decisive armoured engagement, forcing even more reliance on Anglo-Canadian artillery and anti-tank forces that supported First World War-style bite-and-hold infantry-first tactics. When faced with an enemy with superior technology in the way of armour massed to fight a decisive defensive battle, Anglo-Canadian attacks floundered and saw their infantry forces savaged by the Panzerwaffe, the German tank arm. The RA and RCA in return pummeled the German tankers and Panzergrenadiere, armoured infantry. But despite their best efforts, it was found that ground could not be captured by concentrated artillery fire alone. This massive German defensive effort saw a large number of panzer divisions manoeuvre in a small operating area in Normandy, totally disrupting Anglo-Canadian offensive operations. This two-volume work will chronicle in detail the defensive battle fought by the 1st SS Panzerkorps, one of the most powerful panzer corps in Normandy, between the 18th of July and the 3rd of August 1944. It will argue that the Germans gained a defensive success, achieving their strategic aims in that sector of the front. During this time, the Corps deployed the majority of the most powerful formations available in France, and came the closest of any German Corps to matching Allied combat power in its sector. However, this temporary defensive victory, and the cost of stripping other sections of the front, would lead to eventual disaster for the Germans when the western sector of their front collapsed. While the massive British, the 18th to the 20th of July armoured assault, Operation Goodwood, has been studied intensively by European military historians, and was the subject of countless British Army Staff College battlefield tours seeking to learn lessons on how to defeat Soviet tank armies in the Cold War period, no specialised study of German defensive efforts during the latter part of the month exists. Canadian military historians have produced narratives primarily using first-hand accounts of 2nd Canadian Corps operations in July and early August 1944, but little detail is provided on the other side of the hill. Apart from German accounts and the writings of late Canadian military historian Roman Yaramovich, descriptions of the powerful German counterattacks that came in late July are almost unknown in the Western historiography of the campaign. The fighting from the 18th of July into the beginning of August resulted in very high Canadian and British casualties in both men and equipment, in return for minimal gains. Despite the best efforts of Anglo-Canadian forces to control and fight past the formidable Verrieres and Bourguebus ridges, the Panzerwaffe struck back in a series of counterattacks that saw almost all of the vital ground remain in German hands, with heavy casualties on both sides. While numerous works have been published on the Waffen SS in Normandy, much of it is in French. The works in English often lack detail, presenting only an overview of events and brief sketches of personalities and formations. German post-war accounts written by those involved are largely based on memories rather than primary documents. To properly tell the story of the 1st SS Panzerkorps, a clear picture needed to be painted of the Corps' headquarters organization, its commanders, and its conduct of operations, with a detailed account of the defensive battles of the divisions under its command. While numerous publications exist on the Panzerwaffe and their battles in Normandy, no detailed study of a Panzerkorps in this theatre and how it actually functioned existed up until now. What spurred the author to undertake this project? The subject matter of this work was influenced by the work of the aforementioned late Colonel, Canadian Army retired, Roman Yaramovich, whose 1997 McGill History PhD dissertation, The Quest for Operational Maneuver in the Normandy Campaign, Simmons and Montgomery Attempt the Armoured Breakout, provided the first details on the significant German armoured operations in July. Another key inspiration was the writing of Colonel, U.S. Army retired Douglas E. Nash, whose groundbreaking work, From the Realm of a Dying Sun, Volume 1, The 4th SS Panzerkorps and the Battles for Warsaw, July to November 1944, was the first study to accurately detail how a Panzerkorps headquarters actually functioned operationally on the Eastern Front. A third influence was the late author of several histories of the Waffen SS, Major General, British Army retired, Michael Reynolds. His 1997 work, Steel Inferno, the 1st SS Panzerkorps in Normandy, was the first Anglophone work to provide a comprehensive overview of Waffen SS operations in this theatre. While not a trained historian, Reynolds's passion for the subject allowed him to present an accurate picture of the divisions under corps command of the 1st SS Panzerkorps. Reynolds followed up this publication with a second work entitled Sons of the Reich, the 2nd SS Panzerkorps in Normandy, Arnhem, Ardennes, Eastern Front. This later book chronicled the divisional operations of the 2nd SS Panzerkorps in Normandy, some formations of which were placed temporarily under the 1st SS Panzerkorps command during the July fighting. This study will attempt to build upon the accomplishments of Reynolds and delve further into the inner workings of the headquarters of the 1st SS Panzerkorps during its defensive battle from the 18th of July to the 3rd of August 1944. Finally, this book will analyse the strategic impact of Anglo-Canadian operations in late July on the overall German defensive strategy in Normandy. The effect of this fighting in weakening the remaining front has not been fully integrated into the Western historical explanation of why German defences in Normandy collapsed. The conclusion presented in Volume 2 will illustrate that the successful tying down of powerful German forces near Caen critically depleted other sections of the Normandy front. This German deployment thus allowed other Allied operations, most notably the 25th of July's Operation Cobra, involving US forces, to succeed, sealing the fate of the German land forces in Normandy. Western works on Normandy mention Anglo-Canadian operations in the 8th and 12th British Corps and 2nd Canadian Corps sectors, but do not acknowledge the scale of the German concentration opposing them. Nor do prominent histories of the campaign specifically highlight just how weak this concentration rendered the neighbouring German 7th Army to the west. This diversion of resources deprived the 7th Army of mobile armoured formations and the fuel and ammunition to employ them effectively to deal with a major US offensive. And if the role of the British 2nd Army was pivotal in creating this situation, should the impact of Anglo-Canadian operations be acknowledged as a crucial tipping point within the Normandy campaign? By committing the most powerful units within the 8th British and 2nd Canadian Corps during late July to engage the mass of the available German Panzerwaffe for nearly 2 weeks, key strategic goals were accomplished, albeit at a terrible cost. The author also sought to gain a greater understanding of the commander of the 1st SS Panzerkorps during the July fighting, SS Obergruppenführer und Panzergeneral der Waffen-SS Josef Sepp Dietrich. Portrayed by Western military historians as a National Socialist promoted well past his abilities within the Waffen-SS, a conclusive appreciation of Dietrich's command abilities was needed. While many authors have focused on Dietrich's reaction to the 20th of July 1944 bomb plot and attempted assassination of Hitler in this period, the author decided more work could be done in examining his role as battlefield commander. Conducting the research needed for this work was a daunting task, considering the lack of primary source material. At the conclusion of the war, many documents, including the invaluable Kriegstagebücher, war diaries maintained by the Corps and Army Generalstab officers, General Staff officers of grades 1A, 1B, 1C and 1D were destroyed, or in the case of the Waffen-SS, deliberately burned in their storage archives at a castle near the village of Sassmuck in the German Protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia in May 1945. However, some primary documents did survive, and a major effort was made to obtain copies of them. The key remaining primary source relevant to the subject matter of this work is the Panzergruppe West 1A Kriegstagebuch and supplementary documents for the period June to August 1944. As the army-level headquarters that commanded the 1st SS Panzerkorps, one of several corps under its command as an army-level formation over the course of the campaign, documents of this organization and the higher Heeresgruppe B, Army Group B, to which it was subordinate, did survive. These war diaries were invaluable, as while the 1st SS Panzerkorps' 1A Kriegstagebuch did not survive the war, its daily reports were forwarded to and recorded in other forms by Headquarters Panzergruppe West. These reports, reviewed before their transmission by the 1st SS Panzerkorps' Chef des Stabes, Chief of Staff, SS Oberführer Fritz Krämer, tell the story of the daily operations of the Corps and its formations. Another key surviving primary source is the July and August 1944 reports to the Generalinspekteur der Panzertruppen, Inspectorate of Armored Troops, which survived the war. These reports contained the daily status of operational armored fighting vehicles and other strengths within the formations of the Corps, and often more accurately relayed the result of operations than German war diary entries. When confronted with a total lack of information, the liberal use of Canadian and British primary documents and secondary sources fills the gaps where no surviving German accounts of specific operations exist. Often these documents, including intelligence summaries, after-action reports and war diaries, provide a wealth of information that, if pieced together, supply a high level of detail. Though there are often incorrect statements, these inaccuracies can be readily exposed by comparing multiple accounts of the same event. Every attempt has been made to present the historically accurate titles for military units and military ranks for each nation involved as they appear in primary documents in the language they were written. German ranks, units, formations, units, terms and equipment will use their German designations. For the Waffen-SS and Heer, this means using SS-Hauptsturmführer and Aufklärungsabteilung and so on. Also, a detailed chart is presented within the appendices with Second World War British and US Army rank equivalents, as well as a glossary of German terms used. For the sake of brevity, abbreviated versions of the German ranks will be used, such as Osturmbahn for SS-Obersturmbahnführer, SS Lieutenant Colonel. Divisions, corps and armies have their proper titles as they appear on archival primary documents and were typed by staff officers in each army during 1944. While German Armeen had Arabic numbers, the Allied armies' titles were spelt out, e.g. 1st US Army. In another example, the 8th British Corps used an Arabic numeral in wartime documents rather than the Roman numerals used for the US Army's 7th Corps and the Waffen-SS 1st SS Panzerkorps. In conclusion, this two-volume work has utilized the vast majority of all relevant resources created or archived in the past 76 years to facilitate the publication of an accurate historical narrative of military operations and present new conclusions. The result is a detailed critical account of 3 weeks of intense German defensive warfare within a vital sector of the Normandy bridgehead front. These battles would result in temporary tactical victories for the Germans and a bloody nose for Anglo-Canadian forces, but the inability to swiftly shift the panzer divisions involved to the west, as well as the inability to cope with the attrition and movement restrictions inflicted by the Anglo-Canadian artillery and air forces, would contribute to eventual strategic defeat in France. Chapter 1. The German Way of War in Normandy, July 1944. Before beginning a description in the next chapter on what the 1st SS Panzerkorps was and how it functioned in late July and early August, a brief discussion of the German approach to war in Normandy in the summer of 1944 is required. By addressing a number of key topics with examples from the late June 1944 fighting in the bridgehead, the listener can better comprehend the military situation in which the Germans found themselves within their defences by mid-July. During the Normandy fighting, Anglo-Canadian formations in the eastern portion of the bridgehead faced well-equipped, semi-mechanised units that had an adequate amount of armour and medium-quality infantry. German units at times performed well enough that there were occasions where Anglo-Canadian units suffered reverses and were driven out of their positions. Luftwaffe, German Air Force, ground attack assets in July were active by day and night, seeking to actively bomb and strafe enemy positions. Enemy artillery units occasionally attempted counter-battery fire and sustained bombardments of targets of importance. Groups of German panzer, armor fighting vehicles, often with infantry support, launched coordinated counterattacks that inflicted significant casualties on Anglo-Canadian units. As shown in Chart 2.1, the Germans had the resources to inflict significant losses on attacking Allied units in very short periods of time. The British Second Army during this period was facing a militarily effective enemy that sought to destroy, or at the very least contain, the eastern section of the Normandy bridgehead established in June 1944. Examining the three traditional combat arms of the German land forces in 1944, these being artillery, armour and infantry, what were the strengths and weaknesses of each in Normandy? Some German combat arms units, such as the Panzergrenadier manning the 7.5cm Pak 40 anti-tank guns of the 1st Battalion SS Panzergrenadier Regiment 25, provided an effective anti-tank defence against the attacking B Squadron of the 27th Canadian Armoured Regiment, as illustrated in Figure 2.1. Examining this figure, it shows the anti-tank gunners inflicted significant tank casualties during the Canadian assault of the 8th of July, before eventually being overwhelmed by multiple attacking infantry regiments and elements of armoured and anti-tank regiments. It was due to the performance of these units and others that the German front in Normandy did not disintegrate in June 1944 and managed to hold on until early August. Other units in combat were overwhelmed by the Allies very quickly, often despite their best efforts and due to no fault of their equipment. For a multitude of reasons, these forces would only survive contact with the Anglo-Canadian enemy as cohesive fighting forces for a few hours, maybe less. The fighting in Normandy was first and foremost a campaign fought by artillery forces. Significant Allied resources were devoted to endlessly bombarding the Germans with indirect fire and providing anti-tank direct fire support to their infantry and armoured units during their operations. Faced with the challenge of providing at least an equal level of indirect and direct fire support and effective counter-battery fire to the armoured and infantry forces on the front lines, Der Deutschen Artillerie forces in Normandy were overwhelmed. The German artillery arm in 1944 consisted of no less than a dozen different types of units and formations within the Heer, some of which were duplicated within the Waffen-SS, from Sturmartillerie with Sturmgeschütz armored vehicles to Festungsartillerie Batterien batteries operating within concrete casemates along the Atlantic Wall and other fortifications. The dedicated artillery forces at the divisional level fighting within the 1st SS Panzerkorps south of Caen were the Panzerartillerie and Artillerie Regimenter regiments, each with a mixture of captured, self-propelled and towed artillery, the Panzerjäger anti-tank Abteilungen detachments that could provide direct fire support with towed Panzerabwehrkanone, PAK, anti-tank guns and Jagdpanzer turretless armoured vehicles, and the anti-aircraft flak, Flugabwehrkanone Abteilungen detachments, with a mixture of light and heavy anti-aircraft guns, both towed and self-propelled. At the corps level, a mixture of schwerer, heavy artillery, Werfer, rocket, and beobachtender artillery, observation, Abteilung were present, often organized into Brigaden, brigades. Topping all this off were the organic mortars, pack and flak guns held within the infantry grenadier, Panzergrenadier, and Panzer regiments, and within the divisional pionier, engineer, battalion, and other independent regimental and divisional companies. Independent of the 1st SS Panzerkorps' control, but often involved in ground combat, were the Flakabteilung of the Luftwaffe, of which in France there were a sizable amount, often organized into flak corps, which often contained hundreds of light and heavy anti-aircraft guns. Of these elements, the ones with the least battlefield impact in Normandy were the Panzerartillerie and Artillerie Regimenter at the German divisional and corps level. While armoured, assault gun, anti-tank and some select infantry units fought with skill and utilised their indirect and direct fire weapons to the maximum to try to overcome numerical and firepower inferiority, the German field artillery regiments were consistently outclassed, despite their best efforts. They were dominated on the Anglo-Canadian front in Normandy by the RCA and RA due to their being starved of standardized weapons systems, mechanization, effective command and control, signals security, and ammunition itself. The levels of doctrine, communication, and organization that allowed the RCA and RA to concentrate massive force were not present in the German artillery organization. When confronted with an opposing artillery force that had nearly bottomless amounts of ammunition at its disposal, as well as sophisticated targeting systems, effective wireless communications, radio triangulation capability, advanced counter-battery capability, and effective sound-ranging, flash-spotting, and aerial observation units, not to mention its own independent command structure, the Germans were overwhelmed. British and Canadian RA and RCA forces, using the resources listed earlier, could quickly organise effective counter-battery fire against active German artillery batteries. This forced German artillery tactics to focus on short and concentrated fire missions to achieve a specific purpose, usually during a defensive crisis. Coordinated fire was executed by brief radio messages if telephone landlines were severed. These messages containing a target code word and a timing issued 12 to 15 minutes before the fire strike. To avoid systematic destruction by never-ending Allied counter-battery fire, movement of artillery units had to be constant and was usually carried out in the hours of darkness. Danger from airstrikes was also something to be regularly monitored. USAAF, United States Army Air Force, and RAF, Royal Air Force radio nets communicated in uncoded, clear speak, and the German artillery regimenter monitored these frequencies to detect evidence of an incoming mission in progress. The luxury of creeping barrages, endless concentrations, and speculative counter-battery fire, tactics practiced ad nauseam by the RCA and RA regiments, was for the great majority of the time an impossibility for German artillery forces. While devastating to Allied infantry morale and able to inflict huge blast effects on their targets, German naval Werfer rocket artillery units were inaccurate, and their ammunition supply was limited. Furthermore, the launching site was easily recognizable, meaning Anglo-Canadian counter-battery fire soon arrived. Largely horse-drawn within the average German infantry division, artillery units could not redeploy quickly in the manner of Allied artillery formations. Lack of ammunition and fear of counter-battery strikes saw German artillery activity drop significantly by July 1944. Interception of radio traffic and triangulation led to heavy losses inflicted by surprise concentrations on suspected German battery positions from RA and RCA field batteries. The seemingly limitless Allied ammunition stockpiles also led to concentrations being directed at any German position that transmitted wireless voice traffic, be it from a panzer crew commander or an artillery forward observer. The US Army consumed a daily average of 1,500 tons of artillery ammunition during the Normandy campaign, in comparison to an allowance of 480 tons for the German 7th Army facing it. There seemed to be no lack of shells on the Allied side, and the artillery arm fired with absolutely no restraint. Correspondingly, RCA field artillery unit battle casualties dropped significantly, as the Germans made fewer and fewer attempts at sustained counter-battery fire. German panzer grenadier regiments consequently found themselves primarily depending on their own organic mortar units to try to smother Canadian infantry attacks. It was these indirect assets, with 8cm and 12cm mortars, that sought to make up for the failures of division and corps-level German artillery units. Supporting the German infantry in a manner similar to the tanks of the Panzerwaffe were the most functional and effective arms of the Heer and Waffen-SS artillery forces, the Sturmgeschütz, Stuck, self-propelled assault gun, and Panzerjäger, tank hunter, units. The Panzerjäger 4 L-48 and Sturmgeschütz 3 Ausführung G vehicles, taken as examples present during the fighting chronicled in these two volumes, had low profiles and effective armament, and the crews were proficient at working with German infantry in both offensive and defensive operations. This last attribute was not always the case with German panzer units. The vehicles and their aggressive crews were often utilized by German commanders as a substitute for tanks. While they were armored fighting vehicles, AFVs, the lack of a rotating turret and lighter armor limited their offensive capability in some respects. However, the Sturmgeschütz crews were very good at their jobs and recognized their limitations, adapting to support the infantry and carrying out anti-tank roles. Best employed in defensive or ambush positions, the Stuck 3's low-profile and hard-hitting 7.5cm Stuck 40 L-48 tank cannon extracted a high toll on Allied armor and infantry during the course of the war. While most towed pack anti-tank guns were employed in organic companies in the Panzergrenadier or infantry regiments of divisions, some were employed at the corps level as independent units to be employed within a corps frontage. These units could be attached to various divisions as required or employed within a defensive focal point. Operating weapons such as the 8.8cm PAK 43-towed anti-tank gun, these forces could inflict high numbers of losses on Allied armor in the correct battlefield conditions. However, they were very vulnerable. The ferocity of the Allied artillery barrages would often eliminate the crews and guns before an Anglo-Canadian attack reached them. Fighting the anti-aircraft battle, flak forces of the Luftwaffe, Heer and Waffen-SS were equipped with some of the best indirect and direct fire weapons, operating very much in an anti-aircraft role, but also capable of engaging ground targets if the situation demanded it. Due to their high velocity, these guns were effective at long range and had an immediate battlefield effect on advancing armour and infantry. An Anglo-Canadian infantry company with a squadron of tanks supporting it could often find itself attacking a dug-in 8.8 cm flak or quadruple 2.0 cm flak-feeling anti-aircraft guns. These weapons could damage or destroy a Sherman tank and could start a firefight at ranges in excess of 2,000 meters. Larger guns could also operate in the indirect role, the most effective and famous of all these weapons being the 8.8 cm 1836-37-41 anti-aircraft and anti-tank artillery gun, developed in the 1930s. These guns were operated by Panzer, Panzergrenadier and Infanterie ground forces, and Luftwaffenfelddivisionen, Luftwaffe field divisions, in the Normandy bridgehead. Due to the inability of the Luftwaffe day fighter forces to impose a semblance of air superiority or destroy large numbers of the Allied fighter bombers constantly operating over the German front lines, flak units were often the only force capable of combating these raiders attacking German front line and rear positions. Indeed, they were responsible for the line's share of Allied fighter bomber losses in July and August 1944. Supplementing the flak units of the forces named were independent Luftwaffe flak formations deployed to defend the airspace of occupied France. Due to the increasing number of strategic bombing missions over Germany in 1942, a significant effort had been made to increase the number of flak emplacements on their flight paths. What this meant was that there were plenty of flak batteries that could be employed in a ground role by the local area commander in an emergency. As the British Second Army pressed forward near Caen in July 1944, and the German lines needed strengthening, available or nearby Luftwaffe flak units from the 3rd Flak Corps were at times pressed into ad hoc service. This was a rarity because the flak units recognized that this would lead to their almost assured destruction. The dedicated anti-aircraft models of the 8.8 cm flak had high profiles and were easy to locate on the battlefield. Since they were not anti-tank guns, they often had no shields and could be silenced with one high-explosive, HE, shell from a Sherman or sustained fire from a 50-caliber tank machine gun. This led to a limited combat life expectancy of just a few hours, but they could nevertheless slow down Allied advances, and this was often enough for the local German commander to turn the situation around. The dedicated German armoured corps, the Panzerwaffe, was different from the Panzerjäger and Sturmgeschütz units in that they were their own separate elite arm within the Heer, Waffen-SS and Luftwaffe ground forces. Their role was to destroy the enemy through fire and manoeuvre rather than to specifically support the infantry or to hunt tanks in a defensive role. In Normandy, they provided the backbone of German counterattack capability and were called for first to drive back Anglo-Canadian assaults. Whatever results were gained for German forces on the Normandy battlefield were largely dependent on the performance of panzer crews in combat. To a certain extent, German ground forces had none of the long-distance challenges to logistics an advancing Allied army had, and they could use their meagre resources to their maximum within a set defensive zone, provided that fuel and other resources were present. Aggressive tactics by German panzer units in Normandy were often in contrast to Allied practices. Often without infantry support, German tanks would seek to outflank British and Canadian armoured and infantry advances. They also had no inhibitions about conducting road moves and combat operations by night or day. Engaging targets from long range, they used their armament to its fullest potential. These aggressive tactics could lead to disaster for the German tanks if they ran up against Allied AFVs or anti-tank guns in ambush. They were also very vulnerable to infantry anti-tank weapons in poor light or urban conditions. Yet this did not stop them from doing their utmost to stop Anglo-Canadian attacks on the German infantry. The German tank crews were fully cognizant that they were the force holding together a cohesive front and had to act accordingly. This aggressive attitude and disregard for losses could often bring impressive results, delaying numerically superior forces. Unlike on the Eastern Front, this had to be attempted in small groups. Large groups of tanks were simply too easy a target for a highly sophisticated artillery targeting system or the ever-watching Allied fighter bombers. Everything was camouflaged and dispersed away from the prying eyes of Allied aircraft. Every AFV that could be repaired was made serviceable in record time. In Normandy, apart from withdrawals and major retreats, the German ground forces were not constantly moving and did not consume major resources by conducting constant long-range offensive movement. The British Second Army in Normandy fielded technologically inferior tanks and largely relied on the United States to supply them. The German Panther and Tiger tanks, despite fuel consumption and reliability issues, had highly advanced armor and armament. Some of this armor was sloped, which provided a defensive advantage against anti-tank guns and other tanks. German AFVs were equipped with high-velocity weapons of 7.5cm and 8.8cm caliber, which allowed for a devastating first-hit advantage when it came to tank-against-tank duels. German tanks could also engage targets effectively at much longer ranges than a 75mm gunned Sherman Mark III, which made up the majority of Anglo-Canadian armoured regiments in Normandy. All a Tiger or Panther gunner needed was one hit, while a Canadian gunner might require several shots, preferably from the flank, to get a decisive hit. Allied tanks often came with gasoline engines, whose fuel burned easily. The Tigers and Panthers' engines were also gasoline, but they carried more armour in this area of the hull. The German AFV crews could thus operate tactically with fewer restrictions than Allied tanks, whose tactics were curtailed by technology and the need to have other arms in support. Despite their best efforts and aggressive battlefield tactics, nothing could make up for a lack of numbers in the German armoured units. In Normandy, these units were constantly hindered by a shortage of replacement vehicles and spare parts. As long as the front line was somewhat stable, they could recover damaged or broken down vehicles at night and repair them. However, if the front was in a state of flux and German units were withdrawing, damaged AFVs or those out of gasoline would be lost. An aggressive defence had to be continuously mounted by armoured forces, as the German infantry units were very weak without AFV support. Compounding this situation was the aforementioned lack of heavy field artillery fire in support of troops on the Hauptkampflinie. Continuous German armoured operations to restore the situation led to ongoing losses due to Allied anti-tank efforts. If a unit was constantly fighting, withdrawing and receiving no replacement AFVs or spare parts, the capability of an armoured Panzerkampfgruppe could quickly ebb away. Fighting with the Panzer, Panzerjäger and Sturmgeschütz armoured forces to hold the defensive front line in eastern Normandy against Anglo-Canadian attack in mid-July 1944 were the German infantry formations. These varied widely with respect to officer and non-commissioned officer quality, average age, equipment levels, health and training. The year 1944 saw arguably the last of the highly trained Waffen-SS and Heer Panzergrenadier infantry forces fight shoulder to shoulder with elderly or foreign conscripts of immobile Festung Division static fortress formations, or a slightly better equipped Model 1944 Infanterie Divisionen. Despite the strains put upon them, the Heer and Waffen-SS infantry training systems were still intact and attempting to do their best to produce well-trained soldiers. When employing motivated soldiers, such as the former Hitlerjugend, Hitler Youth, the Nazi youth organization, facing the Canadian troops in June 1944, adequate combat performance could be expected. Despite Waffen-SS units being numerically inferior to their enemy and having limited armoured and artillery support, they delivered a reasonable combat performance in offensive and defensive roles. There were cases where the high standard of operational performance of Panzergrenadier units of the Heer and Waffen-SS was not matched by the average Heer conscript Grenadier Company. By the spring of 1944, the elderly or unfit conscripts, former Russian or Ukrainian prisoners of war, Volksdeutsche, ethnic Germans, and Luftwaffe or Kriegsmarine transfers were not highly trained veteran infantry. These soldiers were not politically committed, often not physically fit, poorly fed, and lacked the high level of training present in the early war German infantry soldier. Once hit with massive Allied artillery barrages, a lack of regular rations, and prompt medical evacuation if needed, low morale often slipped to dangerous levels. It was truly a case of hit or miss for Anglo-Canadian units as to which group they would bump up against. Hard-fighting Waffen-SS, indifferent Polish Volksdeutsche conscripts in a Heer unit, or former Russian POWs and the elderly and unfit from a static Atlantikwall division. The main problem confronting the German infantry forces in the eastern portion of the Normandy bridgehead, and in all theatres by the summer of 1944, was the awesome level of destructive combat power deployed against them. This destroyed German infantry faster than it could be replaced by the training systems supplying newly forming units and established formations. In Normandy, this Allied firepower comprised everything from indirect artillery fire that fired around the clock to naval gunfire from battleships and vast armadas of four-engined bombers deployed to drop bombloads that destroyed entire grenadier battalions within minutes. The 272nd Infanterie Division, one of the formations whose battles will be chronicled in this book, lost over 3,000 men during its 14 days in combat as part of the 1st SS Panzerkorps. These losses annihilated its Grenadier Kompanien and translated into daily average losses of 214 personnel. Despite receiving 600 replacements from the disbanded 16th Luftwaffe Feld Division in late July, its six Grenadier and one Fusilier battalions were losing men at such a rate that it was removed from the front line by the 28th of July. This division was not very strong to begin with. Its combat power was 11,211 personnel on the 19th of June 1944. In comparison, the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division had a reported establishment strength of 20,226 men as of the 30th of June. Other German units, notably armoured divisions, were stronger. The 2nd SS Panzer Division fielding 16,762 men, and the 1st SS Panzer Division Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler, despite training and equipment challenges, fielding 19,618. There was little the German infantry formations could do to prevent their destruction. As defensive battles led to counterattacks, the casualties mounted inexorably. During the course of the Normandy campaign, the best of the German divisions, many of them featured in this book, had their infantry contingents bled white, the Leibstandarte alone suffering 5,000 casualties. German commanders responded by staggering their units rather than placing them en masse in the front lines, with a minimum number up front and a maximum number in depth, the strategy being to reduce casualties. Having poor or inadequate artillery indirect fire support, the infantry divisions turned to within their own organizations for partial solutions. One of the most effective German infantry strengths over the course of the fighting was the aforementioned skilled use of light indirect fire at the grenadier battalion level. The resources for sustained heavy artillery programs, such as lifting barrages or counter-battery fire, were not present for the Germans in Normandy. The response to the inconvenience of weak supporting field artillery was the concentrated use of mortars. German doctrine perceived the medium mortar as a mobile, light weapon that could bring immediate combat power to bear on an enemy. The resulting extensive employment of 8-centimeter Granatwerfer mortar teams was responsible for an inordinate number of Anglo-Canadian infantry casualties. The tactic of bombarding lost defensive positions as Allied infantry consolidated on them was easy, since the target was pre-registered. Mortar crews could conduct intermittent harassing fire or launch an intensive barrage to mark the beginning of a counterattack. A mortar crew's location was also very difficult to pinpoint and suppress. The weapon itself could be broken down and transported by a four-man crew. A 1944 German grenadier regiment of two battaliona contained 24 8-centimeter mortars and six 7.5-centimeter infantry guns in the way of light indirect assets. These totals did not include the heavy 12-centimeter mortar company that was often present in select grenadier regiments. Mortar ammunition was plentiful, and the boxes of mortar bombs were easy to move forward from the rear. The mortar crew were able to disperse out of sight near the front line, which was difficult for the heavy divisional 15-centimeter and 10.5-centimeter howitzer crews to do. But what exactly did poor performance mean with regard to German infantry units? A major characteristic was a tendency to surrender to advancing Anglo-Canadian forces following devastating artillery and airstrikes. If a unit lacked resiliency and strong non-commissioned officer leadership, the shock of massive explosive power hitting their positions caused irreversible damage to their capability to resist in an organized manner. When a bombardment was followed up with Anglo-Canadian armor and infantry swarming over a unit's positions, its members would often simply drop their rifles and give up. Alternatively, some units would break and run rather than put up stout resistance with all available infantry weapons. Despite the best efforts of veteran German officers and NCOs inserted at the Zug platoon level, the mass of surviving soldiers could not be controlled if panicked. This situation was made worse by the large number of foreign-born infantry conscripts within the Heer and Waffen-SS in mid-1944. As the combat performance of the average non-German soldier got progressively worse as the war turned against Hitler, the gulf between German-born officers and NCOs and the foreign grenadier grew. Due to the experience of poorly trained or non-German grenadier companies being overwhelmed or surrendering en masse, German formation commanders in the later war years began to see certain non-Deutsche or recently raised units as disposable assets with limited value. They were simply cannon fodder to slow down an Allied attack until a stronger, better-equipped German unit could rectify the situation. There was only a limited amount of concern for their welfare and supply. During the summer 1944, the average Heer Grenadier was a conscript, often forced into tactically untenable positions with none of the materiel and support advantages afforded an Anglo-Canadian soldier. In many cases, German infantry who were surrounded had no capability to withdraw, and there were no reserves to break through to their cut-off positions. To achieve a tactical or strategic goal, the German High Command had no reservations about condemning a low-quality formation to destruction or surrender. Examples of this occurred during July's Operation Goodwood battles, when some German Luftwaffe Felddivision Jäger, Luftwaffe infantry battalions, were placed on the front line to buy time defensively, until stronger German armoured forces could be brought forward to restore whatever was left of the situation. These decisions seriously affected German morale, as no soldier happily looks forward to certain death, wounds, or capture. Since only small resources were deployed to rapidly support them, they were helpless against sustained air and artillery strikes that pounded their positions. If surrounded, the realization hit that they would have to pay with their lives to achieve the German High Command's dubious goals. When unsupervised by officers or NCOs, conscript German line infantry would often surrender if they were unsupported, hungry, cut off, or had little chance of survival. This meant that on the grand balance sheet in Normandy by the end of July 1944, 55,135 German soldiers of all trades were casualties, as recorded by Heeresgruppe D, or Oberfehlshaber West as it was commonly known, headquartered in Paris. A large segment of these ended up as POWs. The German High Command was thus writing off its own soldiers to gain time for powerful, favored, and reliable formations to counterattack and achieve victory. These command decisions occurred at a time when there were a finite number of infantry soldiers available to the German military. The manpower crunch was seriously beginning to bite due to the catastrophic defeat Germany had suffered in 1944. Decisions to simply dispose of whole infantry divisions to Anglo-Canadian prisoner of war cages were highly questionable. The fighting within the Normandy campaign was characterized by severe German infantry casualties. This was largely due to the numbers that surrendered, in contrast to those that were annihilated by artillery, airstrikes, or infantry ground combat. While other combat arms also suffered, the grenadier casualties were out of proportion to armored and artillery personnel operating in the same area. On the other side of the spectrum, despite near-total Allied air superiority, rear services and supply troops suffered little. The tail could be intact in a German formation, while its frontline infantry teeth strength could be reduced to less than 100 men per grenadier battalion. Critical to the success of German ground forces halting the rapid expansion of the eastern Normandy bridgehead in June and July 1944, with the employment of effective defensive tactics to slow down the British Second Army. From July onward, apart from local counterattacks, German ground forces were on the defensive. Having no alternative, these units facing the Anglo-Canadian armies sought to adapt to their limitations and to conduct a successful defensive campaign. They attempted this by capitalizing on their remaining strengths to inflict maximum damage to slow or halt Allied operations. This led to older tactics being adapted to the new situation in an attempt to defend large areas of territory with limited resources. In this situation, it became imperative to utilize whatever advantages were present. While lacking the initiative, the Germans could analyze where and when the British Second Army could possibly strike. They would then decide where to hold off Anglo-Canadian forces and where to give ground. If their forces were skillful enough, they could successfully ambush advancing Anglo-Canadian reconnaissance, armor, or infantry formations in both their delaying and blocking operations. The sometimes ponderous Allied advance, coupled with 4 years of German military occupation and the defenders' established knowledge of the area, did in some cases allow for the construction of impressive defensive works. These advantages often negated Allied armoured, artillery and air support combat force multipliers. However, the norm of 3-to-1 attacking odds was often negated by the strength of these German bunkers and gun positions, and Anglo-Canadian commanders, wary of infantry casualties, often attacked at 1-to-1 odds. Allied forces would also often attack on a narrow front to concentrate their combat power. In turn, this allowed the Germans to concentrate all possible fire on this restricted area, increasing attacker casualties. When a German defensive victory was achieved, it was rarely due to a lack of Anglo-Canadian determination, effective tactics, or sufficient firepower. The German method of defense was sophisticated. German defences began with a line of thinly manned outposts, with riflemen, small infantry mortars and MG-42 machine guns. These outposts were some 400 metres from enemy forward positions. In front of the outpost line would be anti-personnel and anti-tank mines on obvious routes of approach, but not many. The deployment of minefields or the digging of anti-tank ditches was very much dependent on whether German armour needed to traverse the area and how long the Germans had been in possession of it. Further in front of the outpost line would be pre-registered targets for mortars and artillery. This line of outposts would be held for as long as it took to ascertain the direction and strength of the Anglo-Canadian attack. If radio communications or field phones were not installed, flare guns could be used as a signal for tanks or infantry reserves to be moved up. The telltale Anglo-Canadian creeping artillery barrage would alert the defenders regardless. The non-stop tactic of sniping, as it is referred to within Anglo-Canadian unit war diaries, was often the work of these outposts. This was not done by dedicated snipers, but often by infiltrating German soldiers using their weapons at maximum range. This tactic had the potential to impair enemy platoon movement and inhibit a battalion attack. Behind this outer perimeter were stronger German advanced positions at the company level that interlocked with each other and contained MG-42s on tripod mounts and more riflemen. These positions were located 1,500 to 2,000 meters from the enemy. Behind these, at the battalion level, was the main line of resistance, or HKL, positioned up to 5,000 meters from the enemy. This distance illustrates the German belief in depth and how they utilized the concept. In these positions were 8-centimeter mortars and 7.5-centimeter anti-tank guns of the mortar and anti-tank gun Suga. Further behind these positions were camouflaged Stuck 3s or Panther tanks in ambush positions. The armor could assume the counterattack role immediately and begin to maneuver to hit Anglo-Canadian forces in the flank. The mortars and anti-tank guns would be sighted so they could fire at targets attacking the company-level positions and have free fields of fire so that they could use their maximum range. Tripod-mounted MG-42s in the sustained fire role would be fired on fixed axes or within interlocking arcs in order to cut down attacking Canadian infantry following their moving artillery barrage. Anti-tank ditches, other obstacles, and anti-tank and anti-personnel minefields were present in Normandy, but not in such large belts such as were often found on the Eastern Front. Due to the depth of their positions, German commanders could enact a mobile or elastic defense as the battle progressed. This defense caused continuous damage to the attacker, as the defenders would withdraw before becoming decisively engaged. Ground would be surrendered, but in exchange for damage done to the enemy. If the defending German units needed to withdraw a small distance tactically, they could. With the attacker sufficiently weakened over time, the defense would bounce back with a counterattack at the right moment, with reserves set aside for this purpose. Despite the effectiveness of the German defensive doctrine described earlier, certain tactics practiced successfully on the Eastern Front failed miserably in Normandy. That of the immediate counterattack to regain a small area of lost ground or prominent tactical feature was a wasteful exercise that rarely succeeded. This was a practice that sought to evict Commonwealth infantry companies and supporting assets that were consolidating on a newly conquered former German position. The German infantry often did not have the panzer or artillery support, nor numbers to expend what little strength they had to recapture lost ground. Anglo-Canadian artillery, anti-tank, machine gun, mortar, and tank fire would crush these attacks. This was due to the British Second Army anticipating routine German counterattacks and quickly fortifying its new positions. Anglo-Canadian defensive assets were rushed into newly occupied objectives to seize the opportunity of destroying the attacking Germans in the open, utilizing the maximum number of weapons systems. The immediate counterattack was almost always the wrong move for a German commander, unless it was executed very rapidly with overwhelming forces or the opposition was weak. The correct choice in most circumstances was to utilize powerful reserves, but only at the right moment against a weakened enemy that was on the move or not firmly established. The most dangerous and effective aforementioned Anglo-Canadian weapons system, and the one used most often in the Caen area of operations in Normandy, was the field artillery of the RA and RCA. Its overpowering dominance at times totally inhibited all German operations. As previously stated, the Heer and Waffen SS artillery arms had terrible challenges that impacted their ability to fight in Normandy. The number of German corps and army-level independent formations in Normandy was relatively low compared to the firepower that the Anglo-Canadian forces could muster in their Army Group Royal Artillery, AGRA, formations. Fully equipped and functioning at a high rate of combat efficiency, the RA and RCA units within the artillery order of battle for Phase 1 of the 26th of June's Operation Epsom was imposing. 23 field regiments with 384 25-pounders and 168 105mm guns. 8 medium regiments with 96 5.5-inch and 16 4.5-inch medium guns. 3 heavy regiments with 24 155mm and 24 7.2-inch guns, and a regiment and a half's worth of heavy anti-aircraft 3.7-inch guns to be employed in a ground roll. To coordinate this fire was a separate RA chain of command and communications infrastructure. During Epsom, part of this firepower would be employed to deliver a creeping barrage on a frontage of 4,000 yards. 3,658 metres, and carry it through to a depth of 4,400 yards, 4,023 metres. This would be fired by 10 field regiments and 5 medium regiments from 0730 to 1016 hours, H hour to H plus 166. This was just for the creeping barrage, and did not include units responsible for counter-battery fire, specific concentrations on enemy positions, concentrations to protect the flank of the 8th British Corps' advance, and defensive fire missions laid on to defeat and break up German armoured counterattacks and troop concentrations. The amount of artillery fire delivered onto the enemy was not only incapacitating, but also destroyed many German strong points, and allowed the following British infantry regiments to surge forward. What was to be employed for Phase 2 is not listed here, but was just as impressive. Also excluded from the previous list of regiments were the RA and RCA anti-tank and anti-aircraft units, just as numerous and able to provide powerful direct fire against air and ground targets. Furthermore, there was also the indirect naval artillery, most prominently the Monitor HMS Roberts and 3 Royal Navy cruisers moored nearby within range of the Epsom battlefield. The artillery of the British Army had at its disposal a large supply of munitions. Large is an understatement, as for Epsom, the ammunition dumps supplying the battery positions contained 163,200 25-pounder, 50,400 105mm, 27,200 5.5-inch and 3,200 4.5-inch, 155mm and 7.2-inch rounds. A total of 250,400 artillery rounds were delivered to all gun positions. This total speaks to the materiel superiority of the Allies and the amount of resources at their fingertips. The reason Allied operations and major attacks had days and sometimes weeks between them was not due to a lack of urgency, drive, or desire to attack. Time was needed to organize the use of resources in the way of artillery and other assets that delivered this massive firepower. This was the price of wealth for the Allies. The military machine they controlled was so monstrous, it was at times difficult to organize due to its sheer size, and the human planning effort needed to adequately utilize all of its resources. Both the assembly and flagrant use of this awesome power were utterly unmatched by the German forces in Normandy at the time. The sophisticated technological advances and communication levels employed by the RA and RCA units and their command structure were superb in every respect.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.